Hello, my name is Rodrigo and I'm thrilled to be here and speak with you a little bit about the saxophone, the alto saxophone. And I'm from Lisbon, Portugal, and I play in the National Guard Symphonic Band, and I studied there, did my master's, I studied in France, 21st century music, and now I'm doing my DMA at the University of Minnesota. So this is an alto saxophone in E flat, and this means that the saxophone needs to transpose a sixth major above. So if we speak as written, is a B flat, low B flat, and do a F sharp. In a concert, speaking a concert is D flat and A. About the keys, personally I prefer to play with sharps, but it depends on the music, because for instance if you change the key, it's going to sound differently. So that's why you need to speak with the composer and understand how it's going to sound with sharps or flat. So it's really important to understand the saxophone techniques. So for the classical saxophone, I don't like this term, but we have hundreds of different techniques. So I'm going to show you some. I'm going to start with subtone. Subtone means under the tone. So tone. Now I'm going to speak about slap tanging. So slap tanging, well, some people think that the term is not really correct, but generally is when you push your reed into your mouthpiece. It's like the same process when you clap your fingers, the noise doesn't come from here, come from the touching this area, and it's going to create like a resonance. So it's something, the same happens in the saxophone. Now we speak about multiphonics, and there is really important to understand how to use it. Some can sound consonant and some dissonant. And I will give you some examples. And it's really important for musicians to work that in terms of playing a scale. Understand how you can fit that and how you can work it like in the context, like to create a sound that's going to fit in that context. I'm going to combine two of things that we spoke about, slap tanging and multiphonics. So how and combining the slap tanging and the multiphonics, you can create different colors, different kind of attack, and you can generate more energy into the piece, and more percussive. So now I'm going to speak about high register, high notes, overtones, and how we can use harmonics to get other notes. I'm going to give you some examples. Or I can use the harmonics of C, and I can try, let's see. glissando is a technique that is possible to use in classical music and jazz, and is connecting two notes using without noticing the notes in between. So. So now I'm going to speak about cyclical breathing. The technique is to be able to play a melody or whatever without stopping the sound. People think that it's breathing at the same time you are blowing, but it's not like this. Anyway, the result is just for the audience to understand that the music is not stopping. Now I'm going to speak about how you can combine some of these techniques to create something interesting, and I'm going to play just a small part of a piece that I really love. When I'm starting a new piece of music, I believe in the composer, the intellectuality of a composer. And the thing is, sometimes you can see hard things to play. But as I said before, if you interact with a composer, we can speak with them, and it's going to be easier to understand what is doable. So, for instance, every time you composers are going to start something new, I think if you're going to compose something that you truly believe, and not you're going to put this technique because it's showing off something, if you truly believe you're going to work in a piece, my opinion, 99% of the time, it's going to work for a musician as well. My opinion, it's really important the relationship between composer and musician, because nowadays the music is more goes deep into the composer, and is more like introspective music, a lot of sometimes idiosyncratic, and it's important to understand what the composer wants and what the musician can give. So that's really important for me as a musician, to understand exactly what the composer wants, and he needs to see what I can do and colors I can do. So for a piece to work for me, needs to have this straight connection between the composer and the musician, because I don't believe in impossible things. So that's just my opinion. So about composers, it's really hard to mention a few because I met some amazing Portuguese, Spanish composers, European, American composers, but I will speak about the more traditional ones. One piece I really love is the Glazunov Concerto, saxophone and orchestra, and it's really important to understand and to listen to that, because it's one of the most important pieces, the repertoire of saxophone, classic. Another one is a Debussy concerto for saxophone orchestra, and he's a famous composer, amazing piece, and I truly recommend that. And Jacques Ibert, French composer, really an virtuosity example of what a saxophone can do, and I truly love to play that piece. It's gorgeous. With orchestra, because the saxophone sometimes played with orchestra, I like to play the Stravinsky, the Emery Concert. really cool piece. I really love to play it when I can, of course. The Mussorgsky with the Ravel's orchestration. Of course, the Bolero from Ravel is, you need to know that. And Prokofiev, Romeo and Juliet. So that's, and I can say like dozens of different other pieces, but I think my opinion is like, it's a good example. And you can start from here, and who knows, you're going to discover other things after.